You're Amanda with Straightsmile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and today we're going to take a step back and get oriented, like a compass. I find when I work with GPs one-on-one in our coaching sessions for their orthodontic cases that this is one of the first things we need to do is get oriented, take a step back, and let's talk about ways we can move teeth and some of the limitations. So some of the resources we might use. So first of all, you need to know your directions. How do teeth move? Where can we move them? And where can't we move them? So let's take a look at some of these photos here and some of the diagnostic records I might use in order to help me make decisions. For example, you're probably familiar with some of these options. We can move teeth forward. We call that proclination. That's leaning those incisors forward, these and these, to make space. We can also expand arches. See how that U-shape is like this? Well, if we widen that U-shape a little bit more, it helps to alleviate crowding because it takes up more space, right? Same thing here. How do we know if that's okay? Expansion and proclination. Well, there's a lot of records. You can't just assume it's okay. Just because the Clincheck or the clear pilot setup says it's okay, or that 6-month smile setup says it's okay, doesn't mean it's okay. You're the doctor. You need to know if that's okay. How do I know if something's okay? Well, first thing I'm going to do is obviously look at the health of the roots and the teeth and the gums. I'm going to look at the panoramic x-ray, see how much bone I have. Orthodontists love some Ceph x-rays, and we use those all the time. We check out the angulation of the incisors relative to the jaws to see if they are in a stable position or an unstable position. Now, we're going into this whole conversation. Do you need a Ceph x-ray? Most orthodontists do take them. Do we always use them? No. So, you know, sometimes I need them, sometimes I don't. Most orthodontists just take them as standard of care. I'm not going to go into that because I have an entire playlist on all those topics. So if you want to watch everything about Cephs, how to read them, how to interpret them, how to get them if you don't have an x-ray, if you need them, ultimately if you need them is up to your own dental practice act in your own state or country. I'm not going to answer that question for you. But if you want to access my Ceph database on all the resources I've made on Cephs, you can just go to my YouTube channel. I'm assuming if you're listening to this, you're already in my YouTube channel, but you need to go to my actual channel. So to do that, go up to the space bar at the top, put in the search bar, Straight Smile Solutions. That'll take you to my YouTube channel, which has a green banner. From there, if you scroll down, you're going to see about 10 to 12 playlists. One of them towards the bottom says Cephs. Have fun watching those. If you have additional questions, I'm glad to answer them. If you really want to know the nitty-gritty on every little point on a Ceph, you probably should get a textbook because I can't even tell you that I know those anymore. There are certain ones that I use and certain ones that I don't, and those are the ones that I know, and that's what I feel comfortable with. So if you want a super easy Ceph analysis to understand, just real basic stuff, I would recommend a Sasuni Plus because it's foolishly easy. Anyone can understand it. It puts everything in layman's terms, not orthodontic terms. All right. So we talked about expansion of arches and proclination. Again, that comes down to perio, bone, Cephs. I like to look at root scalloping. I can't really see that here, but when you retract the lip, if you're seeing that washboard effect of the roots and you can see it prominently or feel your finger as you run it around it, well, then you probably don't want to move the teeth more forward because you're going to push the teeth outside the bone and that will devitalize them and or kill them and or lose them. So let's not do that, okay? So again, I can't say this enough. Just because the Clincheck said you could move teeth forward doesn't mean it's good or healthy for your patient. You are the doctor. You need to decide if that's okay. And if you don't know, you probably shouldn't be doing this. All right, so that was two ways, but there's more ways. How else can we make space? Well, this is one that most GPs don't know that much about, and that's called sequential distalization. Now, not all aligner companies can do this, and it's very difficult to do that in braces, but it's very easy to do it with Invisalign if you do not have impacted third molars. Boom, boom. Like down here, I can definitely get 3 to 4 millimeters on the top and up to 1 to 1.5 millimeters on the bottom, depending on the ridge and how much bone we have. Of course, we got to take a pano to make sure nothing's impacted and make sure we have a nice ridge up there, down here, down here, down here. So obviously can't scoot this one back, right? Because there's a tooth there. But if there was nothing impacted there, I can scoot this one back a good millimeter, millimeter and a half. Then I scoot this one, then I scoot this one, then I scoot this one. Then we scoot the front teeth and mass into the space we created. We call that sequential distalization. Scooting teeth progressively, distally, one at a time, like beads on a string. Takes a little time, not gonna happen fast. Cannot do this in some countries with Invisalign moderate, light, or express. You can only do it with comprehensive. Now in the US, you can do it with moderate, but you can't do much because it takes way more than 20 aligners to do sequential distalization. You're looking at more 40 to 60 aligners. It's not a quick movement, but it's an amazing movement and it's one of my favorites. So I'll take sequential distalization any day over doing IPR. Why? IPR is notoriously inaccurate. And by the way, since we're talking about IPR, you should totally sign up for my IPR webinar, which has just been announced. It's going to be on May 17th at 7 p.m. Eastern. You can register on my website if you go to straightsmilesolutions.com, click on webinars, and you can register. There is a small fee for that course. It's being put on by Garrison Dental. I'm not getting paid, they're getting paid, but they send you an IPR kit and a type of knot. So basically, it doesn't cost anything because you're getting a free kit. So that covers that, and then you can do hands-on and practice doing your IPR on a typodont before you do it on a patient. It's going to be awesome. I'm super excited. I do one of these webinars every year with Garrison, so just once a year, so check it out. All right, so now we talked about expansion, which may or may not be possible, proclination, which may or may not be possible, distalization, which may or may not be possible. What are some other ways? We talked about IPR. Yes, you can do IPR between the teeth. Of course, you're going to need to look at the teeth in the x-ray, make sure you have enough healthy enamel, probably can't do it on bridges, crowns, veneers, fills, interproximal fillings. So some teeth may not be possible to do IPR on. The max amount you really should do, and this really depends on the age of the patient. If it's an older patient, you could do 0.5 millimeters. If it's a teenager, I probably wouldn't do it at all, or 0.2 millimeters max per interproximal space. So let's say your patient is 60 years old. I can get and has no crowns, veneers, bridges, or interproximal fills, I can probably, and has all their teeth in, I can probably get 5.5 millimeters from that. I can probably get another 4 or 5 millimeters from arch expansion, another millimeter or two from proclination. Definitely can get a few millimeters from distalization. Well, what's this is adding up now? Why take out premolars when you can do all this, right? So, like I said, lots of options for moving teeth backwards, forwards, transversely, and IPR, and of course, there's always your extractions. Premolar extractions, lower incisor extractions are also an option. I call those last resort, but if needed, you can always do them. Of course, if the patient has a lot of perio or something like that, or some really decayed teeth, then that's probably what I'm gonna do. If they have healthy teeth, gums, and bones, and or they're still growing, I'm definitely not taking out teeth. There's just no reason to do that. So my goal in my practice, in our practice, is to get a 0% extraction rate. In older patients, occasionally you'll have a lower incisor because it's like if they have perio and there's crowding, that's just the healthiest way to do it. But premolar extractions should be pretty much rare to none, you know, especially in teens and growing patients. It should be flat out zero. So that's my goal. It's kind of a bit of a mantra for me. So hopefully this was helpful and you understand a little bit more about how teeth move and what the options are. And as you do more cases, you'll really get to understand this. And I'm super excited to explain it more to you. If you ever want help with a case, we're glad to help you. You can go to straightsmilesolutions.com. All right, thanks so much.